So guys, today we are going to start with Russian Revolution. So here we are talking about Russian Revolution. Listen to this very carefully. Then I will show you some slides. Chalo, now let's start understanding the Russian Revolution. It happened in 1917. So there is a background to Russian Revolution. Now don't write anything, just listen first. There is a background to Russian Revolution. Now what is that background? In Russia, there was Tsar. Tsar is king. Right, you can write it Czar or Tsar. Both the spellings are right. Now there was a Tsar, and this Tsar still believed in divine rights. He thought that he is like God. So all over Europe, the kings have now been made to understand that there is no divinity in the office of king, but the king in Russia still believes it. The king in France realized this when it was 1789 French Revolution. They tried to revive their position. Then there were 1830, 1848 revolutions, and entire Europe became constitutional monarchy or republic, right? So everywhere in Europe, the kings now know that they have limited powers, but Tsar still believes in it. So politically, this is one problem, because Tsar considers him to be so very strong. So obviously, feudalism is still prevailing there. All over Europe, feudalism has come to an end. But in Russia, feudal institutions are still prevailing. Feudal institutions and practices. Then, in Russia, agriculture was very, very backward. Obviously, it's such a cold country, and you cannot expect a lot of agriculture. But to add on to the problems, the Tsar himself is taking no interest in modernizing the industry of agriculture. There is no industrial revolution worth the name in Russia. And we have read it while doing Russian Revolution, that industrial revolution, that very basic industrialization started in Russia during 1890s. And it was too late, and it was too less to start, right? So politically, economically, socially, the problems were going on in Russia for quite some time. The people were not very happy. Now, to add to the problems of Tsar, in the meanwhile, Japan started becoming a power. When Japan, after Industrial Revolution, Japanese, they became a new challenge for Russia. There was a Russo-Japanese War. And this Russo-Japanese War happened in 1904-5. In this war, a very small country like Japan defeated Russia very comprehensively. So this was like a shock for everyone, that how can such a small Asian country can defeat such a huge European country? When Japan defeated Russia, the popularity of Tsar now started to decline further. People lost any faith in him, that he's such a like nonsense kind of a king who cannot manage polity, who cannot manage economy. Now he cannot even manage our dignity, national respect. At this point of time, people made a delegation. In 1905, people made a delegation and they wrote some demands, and they tried to give that letter to the king that you have to change these things. When people came to meet the king in 1905, the Tsar still was very high-headed. He asked his soldiers to open fire and killed many people. And it was a given Sunday in 1905. So it is now in history called Bloody Sunday. In the Russian history, it is called Bloody Sunday. Many people were killed on that day. Now, this added more frustration for the people. But still, the king was like little strong, and he had a very good prime minister. The prime minister of the king was Peter Stolypin. Peter Stolypin was the prime minister. This prime minister was very intelligent, and he believed in the idea of reforms. And the best thing about Peter Stolypin is that he's very, very loyal to Tsar. He never wanted that Tsar should face any revolt. So he was always telling Tsar that, see, Mr. Tsar, now the times have changed. You have to do some reform. You have to keep people happy. Otherwise, there will be a revolt. So gradually, there was a little possibility that, yes, Tsar will agree to the advice of Stolypin. But when Tsar started agreeing to his ideas of Stolypin, the feudal lords were not very happy. They conspired and got Stolypin assassinated. Now the prime minister has been killed. Nobody is there who can now make Tsar understand that reforms are very important. And it happened in 1911. After 1911, it is believed that the revolution was now, so like it's possible anytime, because people are frustrated, officers are frustrated, and there is no one who can control Tsar. Now, to add to this problem of Tsar, the wife of Tsar, Tsarina, Zarina, wife of Tsar, even she is very spendthrift and not caring for anyone. And her son, the prince was quite sick. And there was no one who can take care of him in the medicine profession, no doctor. So there was a person by the name of Rasputin. We can call him a Tantrik Baba, right? Rasputin. Now, the Tantrik Baba, the magic man, right? He treated the prince and the prince became fit, fine, healthy. Now, Zarina is overwhelmingly influenced by Rasputin. But this man, Rasputin, had many affairs. It is even believed that he then developed an affair with Zarina as well. Now, Zarina is captivated by Rasputin. Tsar is captivated by Zarina. So any and every important decision in the state, who will be given this office, who will be given promotion, who will be getting salary hike, it will be taken by Rasputin. So even the feudal lords and other officers, they wanted Rasputin to be sidelined because Rasputin is very important. They couldn't. So they are now against Tsar and Zarina. Now, this is the situation in Russia before actually the revolution will start, right? People are frustrated. So the reasons are divine right, theory of kings, and then feudalism, backward agriculture, lack of industry, Japan defeating Russia in the Russo-Japanese War. And then in 1905, that Bloody Sunday happening, which is called dress rehearsal for your 1917 revolution. So much so that happened. In the meanwhile, then there is problem that Peter Stolypin, the prime minister, who is very good, who believe in idea of reform, he has been assassinated. And then the issue of Rasputin, who was favorite of Zarina. Now, what happened next? After this, what happened? Now, this man, Tsar, the king, Tsar Nicholas II is the Tsar at that time. And Tsar Nicholas II believes in expansion as well. He wants to have more territory under his control. For his expansion, now, Tsar wanted to expand the territory. When he wanted to expand his territory, there is a problem called Russification. Now, what is Russification? Russification is bring the more territories under your control. And in those territories, whatever is the nationality of the people, whatever is their race, whatever they are, their religions or whatever it is. Let's take one example. What Tsar will do? He will send his army in the surrounding area, let's say in Ukraine, in Georgia, in Latvia, all these countries. They will go, they will kill the men. They will rape the women. The children will be born. The children born are the children of the Russian soldiers. That means the Russian people, the area is Russified. This is called Russification, right? Tsar will send soldiers. They will then go and kill the men, rape the women, forcefully marry them. Basically, it's like raping them. And then the children are born. The children by blood are now Russians. So in all the areas that have been brought under the control of Tsar, the policy of Russification is being followed. So people are very annoyed with this. Now, this Tsar who believes in expansion, the Tsar who believes in divine rights, has another problem. The problem is that he is giving no attention to modernize his army. Right? So the Russian army itself is very, very backward. Now, with this backward army, the Tsar thought that if I participate in World War I, I may further expand my territory. After defeating Germany, I will take over their territories. I will acquire entire Poland and much more to his mind. So that is why he entered World War I, that yes, I will get more territories. Now that he thought that he will get more territories, he entered the war. So what happened? This was Germany. Here we had France and here we had Russia. So here too, it was stagnation, trench warfare going on between France and Germany. So Germans came to Russia because the Russian army was not fully trained. They lacked that modern weaponry. They were not given proper, even food supplies. And moreover, they were not even having shoes and gloves to wear when they had to go and fight in snow. So the Russians, they couldn't match the standards of the German army. And there was a debacle of Russia. The Russians were falling back. Millions of men died. Millions of men were taken prisoners and many went missing. So there is a huge demographic crisis happening in Russia now, where are 550 lakh men. 5 million men have disappeared. And moreover, when so much so that the soldiers have been sent to fight war, you send 5 lakh soldiers, they die. You send another 5 lakh soldier, you send another 5 lakh soldier. So where are the farmers and the industrial workers now? It's complete anarchy, a complete chaotic situation. Because of this, even agriculture is further declining. Now there is issue of food security in Russia. Because of the issue of food security, now the problem is, first you have to ensure food for the soldier. So the little food that was grown, you first ensure that it must reach the soldier fighting the war. So there is food crisis in Russia, right? When this food crisis happened, now the soldiers fighting on the borders, they realize that the Tsar, who is not taking any care of us, neither we have proper shoes, nor we have gloves, nor we have proper food, nor we have proper weapons. We are fighting for him. But at home, our families are dying because they don't have food. Why should we help this Tsar? So under these circumstances, even the soldiers revolted. And now they started coming back. With this started the Russian Revolution. Now I will add a new dimension to this, and then I will go to the slide. And we will save some time today because this is a part where explanations are more important rather than dictation. So what happened in the meanwhile? Russia is the first country where ideas of Karl Marx started becoming very popular. Because of the popularity of the ideas of Karl Marx, George Plekhanov is the name we will dictate. That's what I will show them on slide rather than speaking the spellings of Plekhanov and all. So this is Karl Marx, whose ideas became popular. George Plekhanov became a very prominent name of the Marxist ideas in Russia. And then there was birth of Russian Socialist Party. This Russian Socialist Party was divided into two, the Bolsheviks and the Mensheviks. Bolsheviks and the Mensheviks. The literal meaning of Bolshevik is the majority party. Most of the people are from majority party Bolshevik, and this literally means minority. So the other section of the Russian Socialist Communist people, right? The leader of this party is Lenin, Vladimir Lenin, V.I. Lenin. Now he is a very revolutionary leader who is very, very against the idea of Tsar and against his autocratic rule, dictatorship kind of monarchy. So he always wanted to change Russia. But you know what happened? Because Tsar was so annoyed with him, he had to escape from Russia. And he was hiding somewhere in Switzerland. Right? Now what happens? In Russia, man, Lenin, he himself is not there. People of Russia are fed up with the king. In February 1917, first revolution happened, right? The first revolution happened. This is called political revolution. Now, people are fed up. They don't have food to eat. People are fed up. They are being defeated in the war. And why are they fighting? So that Tsar gets territory. So people said, no, we don't want to fight. We don't want fight. Slogan is no to war. We don't want to fight. Food is the other slogan. Land to the tiller, the one who is cultivating the land, he should be the owner of the land rather than the feudal lords or the king or the church or anything. Aam kisan ke paas zameen honi chahiye, ordinary farmer must be the owner of the land. So land to the tiller, bread to everyone, food for everyone, no to war. These were the popular slogans. With this first revolution happened, people revolted, army revolted. Tsar was advised by his advisors, sir, please run away, people may kill you. So Tsar said, okay, done. I am resigning. No need to go violent. So Tsar abdicated. Now that Tsar abdicated and Lenin himself, the leader of the majority party, is not in Russia. So Kerensky, he became the leader for Russians for some time. When he became leader, the war was still going on. People were asking for bring an end to war. Kerensky became little cranky. He said, instead of, bringing end to war immediately, let us do it in a different way. I will try to continue the war. I will make better strategy. And if somehow I can make the Russians win the war, I will become the hero of the country. People will never ask me to leave and they will make me the next king. Perhaps he had an example of Napoleon. So he said, no, we will continue the war. And when he again sent the soldiers, the Germans again defeated them very badly. Now the Russians they have been completely decimated kind of a thing. So people of Russia were fed up with Kerensky that what the hell are you doing? We ask you to bring end to war, you continued war. The food crises are still going on. There are so many problems. What the hell are you doing? Meanwhile, Germany was surprised that why the hell Kerensky now sent army? We thought that there is a revolution and Russia will leave the war. We will be free from Germany, France, Russia, Western Front, Eastern Front. So Germany thought with the revolution, the Eastern Front will end. Russia will go out of war and we will focus only on the Western Front. We will defeat France and Britain. But Germany was very surprised that Kerensky has decided to continue war. So Germans then sent their secret agents to Switzerland and they contacted Lenin. And they said, we will run a very special train and we promise that we will make you reach within Russia, right? Go in Russia. Now there is no czar. You have to ensure that you bring Russian revolution to final conclusion and Russia must leave the war. Lenin said, I don't even like the idea of war. Why? That I will explain in a while. So Lenin said, all right, let me be there. So Germans ran a special train, gave him some security, and Lenin landed in Russia in April 1917. On reaching Russia, he made one of the most popular announcements, which is called April Thesis, which promised the people what they were asking for. Land to tiller, no to war, bread to labor. And everybody started tilting towards Lenin. Moreover, he was a leader of majority party. So he had a big, big support. Now that Lenin came to popularity, he gained popularity. He challenged the Kerensky's regime. And the Kerensky regime then fell like a house of cards. Lenin took over as the new leader of Russia in November 1917. This is called the Second Revolution. That means within 1917, there happened two revolutions in Russia. One, the February Revolution, and other, the October Revolution. Right? February and October Revolution. Otherwise, these should be March and November Revolutions. Now, why February Revolution should be March and October Revolution should be November? Because at that time, the Russians were using a different calendar than the modern day calendar. So when it is November, all over the world, in Russia, it was October. When all over the world, it was March, in Russia, it was February. So Russians called it February Revolution and October Revolution. Otherwise, it should be March and November Revolutions. So introduction, what is there? March, February and November, October. This I have already explained by 2 months. So March and November, there were two revolutions. We should not call them two revolutions. These are two phases of one single revolution. One revolution. So we can say first accomplished. First means March or February revolution. It is more like political objectives have been achieved, that the Tsar has been changed. Now there is kind of electoral system. And then comes the second one, October, with which the social and the economic objectives were achieved. Now Russia becomes a socialist country, right? So October Revolution is for social and economic objectives, while the earlier March-February Revolution was for political objectives. Then Russian Revolution is considered as a culmination of a series of revolutions. French Revolution, before that there was American Revolution. So it is a continuity of the things, from American Revolution to French Revolutions to the European Revolutions to the Spanish Revolution, this revolution, that revolution. It is the last revolution. By this time, entire Europe has transformed except Russia. All over Europe, we have now constitutional monarchies or republics. There is only Russia, which is still onto the path of absolute monarchy. So Russian Revolution pushed Russia onto path of modern age. Now, even Russia will become a electoral system-based democratic government. Circumstances leading to outbreak of Russian Revolution. So when we talk about the political factors, Russian polity was still monarchical. Tsar was the head of state. I have already explained this, right? It was monarchical. And the concept of divine rights of kings and despotic character, it was still intact. Despotic is king is believing nowhere in democratic principles. He says that every decision will be taken by me because I am God. I have divine rights. In 1917, there was Tsar Nicholas II who was ruling in Russia. Tsar Nicholas II. Now, this Tsar Nicholas, he's a weak and ineffective one. Now, when he is weak and ineffective one, what it means? As I told you in the case of Russian Revolution, if a king is very strong, very powerful, very efficient, and then he claims, I am divine, people still agree. Because king can do anything and everything, people say, yes, look at him. How strong a king he is, how intelligent he is. So yes, he can be a divine person. But when you happen to be weak, ineffective, inefficient, how can you convince people that you have divinity in you? मतलब पागल है ये, कैसे भगवान हो सकते हैं, नलायक आते ही कुछ नहीं इसको तो. So here there should have been a entry, right? The typist should have entered here. He forgot, right? So Tsar Nicholas II was the ruler. He was villain, ineffective, weak, ineffective. Then evils of maladministration afflicting Russia. The administration was being run in such a manner that there were many evil practices. There was corruption and people were suffering at every step of life. That is why the evils of maladministration afflicting Russia. Why they are afflicting Russia? Because king is weak and ineffective, right? So this should have been a sub point to it. But even if it is not a sub point, you have to understand that the statement says that the king Tsar Nicholas II, who is weak and ineffective, he cannot assure proper administration. So there are many evils of maladministration that afflicted Russia, means Russia became weak with it. Let's take some more example. Feudal institutions and aristocratic privileges were still in place in Russia. Now, after doing French Revolution, you all know what I mean by feudal institutions and aristocratic privileges. Now, for those who have not done anything before these classes, what I mean by aristocratic privileges, it means that if I am born in a family of a feudal lord, only then I can become a feudal lord. No ordinary person can become a feudal lord, which means high offices are based on birth, consideration of birth, that you are born in an important family. They are not based on the idea of merit, that he is a meritorious candidate, he is experienced, he has the capacity or capability or caliber, so make him an important officer. No, it is only and only on the basis of your birth in a particular family. So that is what we mean by aristocratic privileges. Rule of law was absent, means there was no law. Whatever the king wants, he can do it anytime. He can change the law whenever he wants to do it, right? So rule of law was absent, and there was arbitrary judicial legal system, means because no law has been written, if you make a particular mistake, what punishment you will get, it is not written. So it is again the wish of the king or the officers. They can give you a minor punishment or they can give you a major punishment for the same crime. So there is no rule, there is no regulation. And then no grievances redressal mechanism. If people have problems, they have grievances, to whom should they go? King is busy in his own lifestyle. Senior officers are not approachable. So whom should people tell that we are having so many problems in the country, right? Then the state authority misused by aristocracy, the feudal lords who are very influential, they misuse the authority. They have been empowered, so they misuse, right? Because they misuse, they do not let people enjoy even their basic rights. And why are they misusing the authority? For personal benefits, so that they can get more money from the people, so that they can make more and more people their slaves. So they misuse the authority. And the common masses suffering, and there was widespread discontent. Nobody was happy. Everybody thought that the king has no concern for the common people. Officers are abusing us and the king is busy. And while he is busy, he is not even capable enough to handle the situation. So the entire political system is about to collapse. And then came that Rasputin affair, right? There is a very famous singer, Boniem, who even sang this song, Rasputin. So Rasputin affair, he is a Catholic monk. Catholic dharma mein vishwas karta hai. He's a Catholic monk and famous for his colorful habits. Bade rangila aadmi hai yaar, colorful habits, rangila aadmi hai, affair hi banata rehta, sara din baitha hua, pata nahi kis kis ke saath hai. And because of his habits, discredited Tsarist regime, people lost faith in the rule of Tsars. They said they are having relations with such a bad person, how could the king and the queen be good now? But this man Rasputin, ek to aajkal Putin hai Russia mein, usme ras kam hai, इसमें ज्यादा था, तो ही इज रसपुतिन, रसीला आदमी, राइट? सो रसपुतिन इंडिस्पेंसेबल टू द रूलिंग फैमिली, राजा रानी के लिए इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, इज वेरी क्लोज टू ज़ार एंड ज़रीना, स्टॉप्ड ब्लड फ्लो ऑफ प्रिंस अलेक्सी सफरिंग फ्रॉम हेमोफेबिया, राइट? बिकॉज द प्रिंस वॉज सिक, ही करेक्टेड हिम, ही मेड हिम हेल्दी. सो अलेक्जेंड्रा एंड हिज फेवरेट्स एंटर्ड हाई ऑफिसेस. सो व्हाट हैपेंड, नाउ क्वीन विल ऑलवेज फेवर हिम ज़रीना, and all his favorites will enter the high offices. This is how Tsarist regime is discredited. So move on to the next one then. After political, there are social causes. Now, what are the social causes? There are class privileges. Same class privileges as we did it in French Revolution. Now, when we talk about the social factors and the class privileges, nobility and the clergymen had high status. The people who are serving as feudal lords and the people who serve the church. So, nobility is feudal lords and clergy is the officers of church. मैंने क्या लिख दिया? Clerk लिख दिया इसको. This is church. Right? So, they had high status. They had privileges. And they monopolized the state offices. All the state offices were under their control. Every officer will come from their family. Now, condition of common masses was very bad. They were suffering and there was the idea of serfdom. Now, what is serfdom? Write a point to this because it is not explained. So, you can write on a piece of paper what is serfdom. Serfdom is slavery or what we call bounded labor. Serfdom is like slavery or bounded labor. So what they are saying, social factors, serfdom abolished 50 years ago before this revolution happened. The serfdom has been abolished 50 years ago, but the condition of the peasantry was still deplorable and pathetic. Let's try to understand. The king said, nobody is now a slave. There is no serfdom. King said this and king forgot I said this. The feudal lords and the church, they still keep people as slaves and nobody is helping them. And if as a slave, I go and I talk to anyone in society, let's say he is my feudal lord. I said, sir, I heard the king abolished serfdom. So am I now free? So he slapped me and said, the king is mad. Right? There is no way that slavery can be banned. Serfdom will continue forever. So the people are surprised that once king said that it has been abolished, it is still continuing. So this discontent produced is by the social inequality. People are not happy that why we are treated like slaves, why we are treated like cattle, why we not having the same rights, let's forget about the privileges. So these are social factors. Then comes economic factors. Among the economic factors, economic difficulties always are an immediate cause. Because when you are having no food to eat, no money to earn, no job to do, obviously you will be more frustrated. And then revolution becomes easier to happen, right? So, this is not India. I hope you understand. This is industrialization. How can India commence in 1890s? Typist, teri aaj chutti karni hai, aake baad mein baat karenge. Ek aadhi galti nikal deta hai, pyari si na. Industrialization commenced in 1890s, but level of industrial advancement was very low. There were hardly like 500 factories in 1917. Such a huge country with having only 500 factories. Like this is very, very bad, right? Then factory workers suffering immensely because there are no laws to protect them. They can be exploited in any what way. No fixed working hours, no minimum salary act. Wages are very less. Workers are working for 12 to 14 hours and not even paid proper. Most of the land was controlled by feudal lords. Lack of industrial and agricultural progress. Even trade and commerce remained underdeveloped. So there is neither industrialization nor there is advancement in agriculture. The trade and commerce is underdeveloped. That means there are so many economic problems. And then add to it, there is rampant corruption and inefficiency. Rampant is widespread. There is widespread corruption. Every officer just keep asking for bribe from the poor people. And inefficiency of maladministration, people are frustrated to the core. Under these kind of political, social and economic causes, the Russian Revolution will take place now after some time. Now, there is a very specific question asked in this exam. Was revolution inevitable in Russia? Like, is it something like this has to happen or could it have been avoided? Inevitable is that it cannot be avoided. It will happen. So was it inevitable? When they ask you this type of a question, that do you think that the Russian Revolution is inevitable or was inevitable? So what should be the answer like? What we'll tell? Here we have the story of Stolypin, the prime minister. So Tsarist regime had degenerated. It is very bad, pathetic. People are not at all happy with it. But Russian Revolution not inevitable in Russia till 1911. Till 1911, there was a possibility that the revolution could be avoided had that Prime Minister Peter Stolypin not assassinated. He may have convinced the king to change the system. And if the system would have changed, people would have been happy. And if the people would have been happy, there would have been no revolution. So that means up to 1911, till the time Stolypin was there, we can still say that revolution could have been avoided. So post loss to Japan in 1905 war, when the Russians were defeated by the Japanese in 1905, Russo-Japanese war, I hope you remember I told, right? When Japan defeated Russia in the 1905 war, Tsar promised reforms to the people. All right, don't worry, I will change the system and we will become powerful again, making Russia great again, kind of a slogan. So, but later he did not keep it. He just make a promise, fake promise. People were told that, okay, I will give you some rights. We will bring democracy. We will strengthen Russia. But then he never kept. More than political reforms, Russians were looking for solution to their economic problems. People do not want right to vote at the very start. They want that they should have adequate means of livelihood. They should get ready-made supply of food. And there should be some kind of prosperity in the society. If people are happy only, then perhaps they will start thinking about right to vote. So initially, it's not that people want democracy or they want the king to leave. Between this time, 1906 to 11, the Prime Minister, PM, it was Peter Stolypin. And Ayushin, I hope you understand what is Stolypin. It is Peter Stolypin, the Prime Minister. He initiated number of steps to improve conditions of the workers and peasants. Like, let's give them some rights. Let's make their life little better so that people are happy and there is no unrest against the Tsar. Russian factories were regularly inspected. He started sending inspectors to factories and to check the exploitation and to liberate the workers so that workers are not made to work for longer hours. They should be paid proper wages. There should be cleanliness, that sanitation should be ensured. Where they work, it should be a healthy place and things like that. Then he introduced land reforms so that poor people can get more land. Peasants were encouraged to buy, not but, to buy own land. He asked peasant, poor peasant to buy their land. And between 1906 to 11, 2 million peasants purchased their land. That's amazing. 20 lakh people bought their land. So people are now happy. Peasants also encouraged to resettle in Siberia. 3.5 million moved to Siberia. With this, the population is now divided so that in different areas they can stay, work and grow food for them and there is food security. Then redemption payment fee for getting liberated from serfdom was abolished. Now, what is redemption payment? Just listen to it and write about it a little bit. If you are a slave, you were a slave and you were bounded by serfdom principle. Now, if I am the master, you are my slaves and you come to me. Sir, the king said you should free us. So he said, all right, kings to say so many things. Now, if you want to get freedom, you have to pay me one time payment. Give me, let's say, 500 rupees in those times or 5,000 rupees or 50,000 rupees, depending on the person. So give me this much money. This is your redemption payment for getting liberated from serfdom. You will make me payment. Then I will give you a letter that, okay, I free you, I set you free and you are no more a slave or a serf. So the Prime Minister said, this is illegal. Redemption payments cannot be demanded. So he abolished. That means now slavery is coming to an end. But then murder of PM Stolypin in 1911 made Russian Revolution inevitable. Now there is no one who can stop it as he was strongest supporter of Tsarist regime. He wanted the Tsar to be safe. And the only way to keep Tsar safe was through reforms. But his reforms were hurting the interest of privileged classes. Feudal lords were not happy that they will lose the powers and their serfs, their slaves will be free. So that is why he was assassinated. So here we are, role of World War, right? So what did World War do for Russian Revolution? So outbreak of World War I made revolution more inevitable. Why? Because Mr. Tsar pushed Russia into the war in hope of strengthening foundations of his regime. He thought, I will get more territory. I will become more powerful. So he pushed Russia into the war but it was a big mistake and proved to be a disaster. Tsar will repent this now. Participation in the war intensified economic sufferings of the masses. The money is now spent on war effort, so people are facing more economic hardship. Administration collapsed. There was no administration for the namesake, and black marketing started. People were not getting food at reasonable rates, and artificial scarcity, people started hoarding the things, right, so that they can sell them at more profit, led to hyperinflation. Now, at a time then when people do not have even basic money to buy the things became super expensive. So, on 8th March, I hope we all know that this is International Women's Day. On 8th March in 1917, group of hungry women attacked shops selling bread. The women came open, like their kids were crying, the women were crying, they needed something to eat, so they attacked the bread shops. When this started, police fired on the mob and 40 people were killed. The people who are hungry, they need food, and you just open fire on them and ended up killing 40 people. With this, massive revolt was sparked. Now everyone came out, even the soldiers revolted. Tsar Nicholas advised to abdicate in favor of his brother, Michel. Now Tsar was told, bhag ja, people will kill you. Tsar said, okay, ask my brother if he wants to take over. Nobody took Michel into confidence and he refused. Okay, maine marna kya? Why should I take this panga now? People are so angry with my family, my brother, now they will kill me. So Tsarist regime collapsed on March 15, 1917. Downfall resulted in political revolution in Russia and liberal government republic formed under Prince George Lvov. Ek prince tha, usko bola tu baith ja gaddi pe. He failed and replaced by Alexander Kerensky. Right, for few days Lvov sat on the throne, but then he failed. People did not like him. So now came Alexander Kerensky. There is a constitution and he is expected to run the country according to the constitution itself. Factors responsible for November revolution. Now first revolution happened, as I told, Kerensky comes to power. Now second revolution. March revolution of 1917, which we just discussed, resulted in downfall of Tsarist regime. Tsar is gone. Political objectives have been accomplished, but the social and economic objectives were blocked by the liberal government of Alexander Kerensky. He is not agreeing to everything that the people wanted. So, liberal government of Alexander is not ready to change the system. In spite of change of government, socio-economic discontent still continued. People are not happy. Now, Alexander Kerensky's government did not undertake any effective measures to improve condition of factory workers. So, factory workers are still being exploited. Land reforms have not been properly initiated. Farmers are facing problems. Promise of holding elections not kept, and the excuse given is war. We want to continue war, and the decision to continue war is the most unpopular decision because people never wanted the war to continue. They were fed up. Right now, when he himself launched the June offensive, that means Kerensky sent Russian army to fight the Germans in the month of June. June offensive launched by a government to win war ended in a new disaster. And this increased the discontent that why the hell you send army when we said bring the war to an end. You continue war to become popular. We don't want this. And at this point of time, return of Vladimir Lenin to Moscow in April 1917 used his writings and speeches to urge the masses. This is April thesis. In the month of April, he came, started writing and gave speeches to people. Now, when Lenin came and he gave his April thesis, people started turning towards Bolshevik Party. Now, Kornilov affair happened. Who is Kornilov? He is the defense officer under Kerensky. Kornilov is defense officer under Kerensky's regime. Kornilov is the name of a person. He is a military officer. Kornilov affair further discredited Alexander Kerensky's government. Now, what is Kornilov affair? Kornilov, in order to counter the growing communism influence, what is communism? Bolshevik Party. What is Bolshevik Party? Party of Lenin. So they never wanted this man to become popular. So Kornilov, in order to counter growing communism influence, tried to wipe out using military action. But when he asked the soldiers to kill the communists, the soldiers sympathetic towards communism and arrested Kornilov himself. Soldiers ne apni boss ko arrest kar liya. that we will not kill Lenin and his members, party members. Rather, we will kill you. Clear that government had no control over armed forces. Army has sided with the Bolsheviks. Lenin and his best friend Tolstoy took benefit of volatile environment, help of Red Guards. Red Guards is the army of the Bolsheviks, right? As China call it Red Army, right? Now Chinese army is called Red Army. So it is Red Guards. On the night intervening 6-7 November 1917, Russia proclaimed communist nation and socio-economic dimension of revolution also completed. This is how two revolutions happened. Let's start. Significance of Bolshevik revolution. This revolution of November 1917, which happened when Lenin comes to power, resulted in emergence of communist regime in Russia. For the first time, a communist regime anywhere in the world has been established. This is first significance. So Bolshevik were radical communist and had no faith in efficacy of liberal socialism. They only and only believed in the idea of communism, that they have to bring state to an end and create an equal society. Immediately after success of revolution, resources were nationalized. They nationalized the resources. Everything is now in the control of state, right? Nationalized, as the banks were nationalized in Indiana, everything will be controlled by state. Nation based on socio-economic equality came into existence. Now there is no private trade allowed. Everything is controlled by the state. So success of Bolshevik revolution transformed communism from theory into practice. Its practical efficacy has now been understood, that yes, communist regime can be established. Before this, it was only and only a theory. Now it has become a practical system of government. Then, success of Bolshevik revolution pushed Russia into a civil war for 4 long years. Within Russia, the Tsar's, old Tsar's forces, called the White Forces, and the communist Red Forces, they started a 4-year long civil war. They fought. Tsar wanted to come back, and the Russian, the supporters of Bolshevik, they never wanted it. Nationalization of resources transformed capitalists of Russia into anti-government forces. Why? Because everyone's property was taken over by the new government. So the capitalist class, the businessmen, they turned against the communists, the Bolsheviks, and they wanted the old regime to come back. So the whites, anti-government capitalists supported by Western nations in fight against communism, that is Red Forces. Who are the whites? Who are anti-government? Whose government is it? Communist government, Leninist government, right? So anti-government capitalists supported by Western nations. Now, why Western nations? This is a very important link which will take us to a future as well. Now, what is the link here? Western nations, they include Britain, France, USA, and Japan, right? Now, they are the all four are capitalist countries. They are all industrialist, capitalist, right? Now, they never wanted that in this world there should ever be a system in which the private property is nationalized. If Russian system becomes popular, then this British, French, American, Japanese system will go out of fashion. So they never wanted that this system should become popular. So that is why Britain, France, USA, and Japan, they even sent money and soldiers to support the Tsarist regime. Now imagine one thing. Russia is turning into USSR under leadership of Lenin. Within their country, they have created conducive environment, but these foreigners are unnecessarily interfering in their internal affairs. This is in 1917. Wait for 40 years. There will be a Cold War between the same players. Right? Why Cold War? Because Russia will not forget this. Stalin will take revenge for this. So Cold War had its seeds in this event when the white forces were supported by the European capitalists. Now, it intensified the ideological differences in the world, ideological differences between the capitalist and the communist. Capitalist and the communist. Communism despised by capitalists. They never like the capitalists, never like communism. It is despised, and rise of communism frightened capitalists in West. And they thought that world will now turn into this. Both ideologies trying to convince masses about their superiority. Struggle to capture hearts and minds of people started. So capitalists will write their literature, they will bring their books, their ideas. Communists will do this. Bolshevik revolution responsible for circumstances leading to outbreak of Cold War after 1945, something that I explained there. Then emergence of communist Russia greatly emboldened communist forces all over the world, and this pushed Western democracies into policy of appeasement. Now, this is something I will explain in chapter on Hitler. Policy of appeasement, creation of circumstances leading to World War II. You remember yesterday I was telling you when Hitler was coming into power, why Britain was supporting him? So that Germany can become a buffer between communist Russia and rest of Europe. So that means Britain intentionally gave breathing space to Hitler. Britain let Hitler become little strong so that Britain can use Hitler against Soviet Union, USSR. But unfortunately, Hitler made his own mind in a very different manner, right? Add one more point to it now, which is not written in the slide. Success of Russian Revolution made communism popular all over the world. Subpoint, Communist Party of India established, and B point, Chinese Communist Party established. Both these parties were in early 1920s. Within 3-4 years, there were many other communist parties that came into picture, came into origin. This is all about Russian Revolution. Great Economic Depression is done. League of Nations is done. Russian Revolution is done. Paris Peace Conference is done. Treaty of Versailles is done. Right? Now, only topic left is rise of fascist forces. Before now I explain fascist forces, I will once again explain communism, socialism. I was telling them there is ideology called liberalism. There is all ideology called socialism. There is something called fascism. We can write it together here, right? Liberalism, socialism, fascism. Then we have feminism, anarchism, and then we have communitarianism. These are 6 main philosophies, 6-7 main philosophies in political science. Liberalism. Now, what is liberalism? I'm not giving you a technical definition, right? Mark my words, I'm not giving technical explanation what we read in political science. It is only to make you understand the concept. So let's say I am the state. I am your prime minister. I am your president. I am your king, whosoever I am the state. Now that I am the state, I make some rules. So in liberalism, the rule is very simple. The rule says that all boys or all girls, whatever caste you belong to, whatever economic status you come from, whatever physical condition you have, right? Whatever caste, whatever creed, whatever religion, whatever economic status, whatever physical health you have, I say I will give everyone only and only equality of opportunity. You all get the opportunity. So tomorrow there is a race. Everyone come and run. You will start from the same point. You will end at the same point. Who will win the race? Who have the merit, who have the talent will be rewarded. Simple. How can I bring the equality of result? I can only bring equality of opportunity. All of you come, run and prove who is the best and take the reward. Simple. Story ends. This is liberalism. So in liberalism, when someone has a talent, he becomes rich and others, they remain poor. Equality of opportunity irrespective of differences. Exactly, RK. Now, this is clear. Now, socialist communists say, don't you even realize this, that there is a boy wearing Nike shoes, Nike Air, and there is a girl wearing a simple slipper. How can they run together? And there is a boy who is not having his leg properly working. There is someone who has like a deep wound in the leg. How can you make everybody run? Where is this equality? So make sure that everyone is healthy. Make sure that everyone have a same type of shoes. Then you can ask them to run the same race. Equality of opportunity without having equality of resources is meaningless. First bring equality of resources, then bring equality of opportunity. This is socialism, communism. We will talk about this last, right? Because we have to start with this now. Now the feminist come. Feminism. A girl comes and tells the prime minister or the president or the king, sir, how can you say that this is equality, that the girls, they cannot run as fast as men? And why are you making us run together? Make some special provision for women, either make women run a separate race or make the starting point of women a little ahead of the starting point of the men, or let the men stand there still for 2 minutes while we start running and then they can run. Something special for women. We are different. We need something different. That is feminism. Right now, there is radical feminism. There is liberal feminism. There is socialist feminism. There is so much of it. We will not go into it. Right? Then anarchism. I am not there. There is no prime minister, no president, no king. Nobody is there. You all are running. For what? No one knows. Where are you running? No one knows. Why are you running? No one knows. Because you are running in any and every direction. Obviously, there will be collision. There will be injury. Now, that is called anarchism. There is no state, no power, nobody telling you what to do. Nobody holding anyone responsible. Everyone is doing whatever they like. There is a mad race. Everyone is running in any and every direction. Yes, siapa hi pyar hai. Next, communitarianism. Now, what is communitarianism? Communitarianism says it is a community of people. We all are with each other. We have to take care of each other. How can you leave somebody? So hold everybody's hand. Start running. If somebody is running very fast, pull him back. If somebody is running very slow, pull him ahead. Right? Push him, pull him, and try to cross the line together and divide the award or reward equally. That's communitarianism. Now, this is fascism. It's like Hitler. Right? Now, what he is going to say? Tomorrow we have a race and the best person will win the race. See you at 9 a.m. sharp. You all will come ready for the race. Before he will say the race starts, he say, okay, he has won the race. He and she will ask, how? He said, everybody started clapping. Oh, you won the race. You won the race. That's fascism. They are dictators. Hitler. He will not let anyone ask him why. He said, I did it. That's it. Don't ask why. Now, let's try to understand the core difference between three. There is liberalism. There is socialism. And there is communism. These are three main ideologies. Pen bhi kharab ho gaya. Batao. Itni baar samjha diya, any ideologies ko maine. So in liberalism, there is private property. There is private property. Everyone has his own property, right? Now that everyone has his or her own property, there is situation of conflict because everyone wants to get more. Because there is a conflict, there is a state. We create state. Now that the state has been created, state make rules and regulations and we all follow them. We want the state to have minimum functions because liberalism says that every individual is very, very intelligent. Every individual is very intelligent. They will seldom do the conflict. Seldom they will do something that is wrong or that can harm anyone. They all are intelligent, though every individual is self-centric. But still they understand that unnecessary conflict, unnecessary collusion will bring some destruction. So nobody unnecessarily fights. Look at this society. We do not fight with each other unnecessarily, right? Very seldom it happens that we fight. And whenever we fight, we try to resolve the conflict ourselves. Every time we will not go to police station or to judiciary, right? We'll try to solve the problems. So give minimum role to state because state is an evil. If you give more power to state, then liberalism says that the state will restrict your liberty, your freedom will be lost. So why you want to give more power to state? So state is an evil, but it is also necessary. Why it is necessary? Otherwise, who will solve the problems? If there is a conflict, then you need someone to solve it. So you create state to solve that conflict, give them the minimum powers and enjoy your life healthy. Now, socialism says that if there is private property, obviously, yes, there is conflict. And when there is conflict, the state is there. But originally, the state is created by the rich class, the haves. the rich who want to exploit the poor, the have-nots. Haves and have-nots. Haves are rich, have-nots are poor. Now, why you need state? I am a very rich man. I have so much money at my home. And then there are so many poor people living near my house. One fine day, they can enter my house and they can take away my money. There can be a theft, there can be a robbery, there can be a murder. So I need state to protect me. So the police, the judiciary, all these things are to protect me. What they have to lose? Nobody will go to their house to steal anything. So why do they need state? And because they have to come and thief, become thief, because I not share my money with them. So they don't want the police to exist even. Right? And why they are bad? Why they are bad? Because they have been denied equality. They have been denied the very basic things in life. Nobody is born a thief. Nobody is born a murderer. Their circumstances make them like this. Right? This is what they say. Now they say that because from liberalism, you cannot come to this stage. This stage is classless, stateless society. Communism is a classless, stateless society. Neither there is going to be anyone who is poor, nor there is anyone who is rich. All are then equal. Because it is a society of equal, there is no conflict. Because there is no conflict, there is no need of state. So a classless society becomes a stateless society. And this classless, stateless society is a communist society. But we live in a liberal world where there are rich and poor classes. Because there are classes, there are conflicts. Because there are conflicts, there is state. And state is helping the rich to maintain their status quo. Now, if you want to jump from here to here, it is impossible. So there is going to be a first stage called socialism. In this stage of socialism, what you will do, you will establish dictatorship of proletariat. Dictatorship of proletariat. Who are proletariat? The working class. Right? Working class will get all the powers. They will decide that how the resources, economic resources are to be distributed. Not the capitalists will decide that how money is to be distributed. The workers will decide how the money is to be distributed. When they decide, they will bring equality in society. They will not let it be. See how the economic differences are created when money is concentrated in fewer hands. A rich person like Mr. Ambani, Adani, they keep all money with them. Then there are millions of workers who work under them and they remain in abject poverty. So if worker gets the power to decide and they are in a dictatorial manner, like no democracy, why? Because if you bring democracy at this stage, then the rich will win the elections. They will again get all the power and they will continue the exploitation. So you establish dictatorship of the working class. They work to bring equality. When equality is achieved, then you get the first stage, classless. Right? Now that it is classless, now there are no conflicts. You keep a check for a while. When it is classless, there is no conflict. Once there are no conflicts, now you are sure that the classes have come to an end and the conflicts ended. Enter the next stage, which is classless. So it is stateless. It is a self-organized, self-regulated communist society. Unfortunately, be it USSR or China or North Korea, they all call themselves communist. Where are they communist? The state still exists. Even the classes exist. In Russia, there were people who were super rich and then they were poor. In China, there are people like Jack Ma and there are people, thousands of people who are still starving. In North Korea, though, we don't even know what is going on. So what right they have to call themselves communist? I don't understand. In India, what we do? The state is doing something like from the rich, we collect the taxes and then we do welfare of the poor. So we are near to socialism. In America, even in America, they are not purely liberal because even they provide social security to the poor, free medicine, free education, and unemployment allowances. Even they are near to socialism. That is why in the modern time, we use the word like social liberal democracy. Now, if I start with the next topic, I'm going to make a very small experiment. I will explain everything on the board, but I will not go to the slides because I end up reading the same things which I have explained. I will explain everything in a much detail, proper explanation. Chalo. Now try understand. First of all, the issue is the term called fascism, from where this term comes, right? In the old times, when there was Roman Empire, in Roman Empire, when there were judges, the magistrates, they used to hold a symbol behind them. In the symbol, there was like this symbol, right? This is like axis. Kulhaadiyan do, right? This symbol. This is a symbol of authority. It is called fascism. From this, the word fascism emerged. Authority, it is authority. Symbol is the, it is a symbol of authority in the Roman times. So from here, the term fascism comes. Now, when I talk about fascism, what is this fascism? It is anti-democracy. They do not believe in democracy. They believe in dictatorship. That, see, we are the people who will decide that what is to be done and nobody will ask why. Fine. It is anti-democracy. Anti-liberalism. They are not in favor of giving so much freedom to the people. They don't want liberty, right? Anti-internationalism. They don't want peace in the world. They want war, right? They are anti-internationalism. They glorify war. They glorify war. Ladai to ladni hai. War is something that is very important. You will not even believe when I tell you the names of the statements given by some of the fascist leaders. Write them. Write those two statements. The statement is given by Italian dictator Mussolini. 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 You know what he said? He said, as maternity is to women, as maternity is to women, औरत के लिए माँ बनना जरूरी है ना, maternity is to women. If a woman will not give birth to a child, people will not like the woman. They will call her style woman, banja औरत. She will not be respected. As maternity is to women, war is to men. They said, as maternity is to women, war is to men. Right? दूसरी statement इसी की मुसलिनी की. A nation should either expand. A nation should either expand or perish. या तो देश बड़ा होगा या खत्म हो जाएगा, बस यही चलेगा. A nation should either expand or perish. कैसी लगी दोनों statements? वो देखना नहीं, जाट जूना मोर सी मुसलिनी. How is the statement? You agree to it? ऐसे में एक स्टेटमेंट और लिख लो, दो स्टेटमेंट और लिखवाता हूं, इसी की है मुसलिनी की सारी. बड़ी प्यारी स्टेटमेंट है, मुझे पर्सनली बड़ी पसंद है. व्हाट ही सेज इज, नथिंग अबव द स्टेट, नथिंग अबव द स्टेट, नथिंग बियॉन्ड द स्टेट, नथिंग आउटसाइड द स्टेट. सब कुछ स्टेट है, जियो मरो इसके लिए. और लास्ट, ask not what the state did for you. Ask not what the state did for you. Tell what you did for the state. Right? फिर star लगा के लिखो इसके नीचे. Man is the mean. Man is the mean. State is the end. तुम देश की सेवा करने के लिए पैदा हुए, देश थोड़ा तुम्हारी सेवा करने के लिए पैदा होता है. Man is the mean, state is the end. This is the crux of fascism. अब समझ आ गया सबको, what is fascism? Expansion करो, लड़ाई लड़ो, लोगों को rights मत दो, democracy की तो बात ही नहीं होगी, rights roots होते ही नहीं है. क्या होते हैं rights? किसके rights? क्यों rights? There is only one right. Prime Minister is always right. Nothing above the state, nothing outside the state, nothing beyond the state. So fascism is anti-democracy, anti-liberalism, anti-internationalism. It glorifies war and expansion. It is anti-rights. It is not in favor of giving rights to the people. It want people to understand that they have obligations. Obligations are duties. So it tell people, you have duties, don't ask for any rights. आज के बाद ये नहीं बोलना कि मेरा फंडामेंटल राइट है, मेरी फंडामेंटल ड्यूटी है स्टेट को सर्व करना है, दैट इज इट। नाउ दिस इज फैशिज्म, डन। पैसा कमाने के और बड़े तरीके हैं बेटा, पढ़ के थोड़ा सारे पैसा कमाते होते हैं। ऑल राइट, सो नाउ कमिंग टू ओरिजिन ऑफ फैशिज्म, सो लेट अस अंडरस्टैंड फर्स्ट, देयर इज जर्मनी, वी हैव हिटलर, देयर इज इटली, वी हैव मुसोलिनी, देयर इज जापान, वी हैव टोजो, देयर इज मैक्सिको, वी हैव मटेस्कास, देयर इज ऑस्ट्रिया एंड वी हैव डॉल्फस, एंड देयर इज स्पेन एंड वी हैव फ्रेंको। दीज आर सम ऑफ द एग्जाम्पल्स ऑफ द इंटरवॉर पीरियड, राइट, वर्ल्ड वॉर वन एंड वर्ल्ड वॉर टू, बिटवीन दीज टू वॉर्स, दीज आर सम ऑफ द एग्जाम्पल्स। सब दिखे हुए स्लाइड में, डोंट वरी, सबके नाम दिए हुए स्लाइड में, सो दे आर द एग्जाम्पल्स। नाउ फ्रॉम वेयर डिड दिस हैपन, हाउ डिड इट हैपन, ओरिजिन, लेट्स टॉक अबाउट इटली एंड लेट्स टॉक अबाउट जर्मनी, देयर आर टू, राइट। नाउ व्हाट हैपेंड, सी, इटली, इटली पार्टिसिपेटेड इन वर्ल्ड वॉर वन, इटली वॉज ऑन द साइड ऑफ द विनर्स, इटली वॉज साइड ऑफ द विनर्स, बट वेन द पेरिस पीस कॉन्फ्रेंस हैपेंड, इटली वॉज डिनाइड इट्स शेयर, इटली वॉज नॉट गिवन द शेयर, सो देर वॉज अ ब्यूटिफुल स्टेटमेंट इन न्यूज पेपर, दैट इज नॉट गिवन इन द स्लाइड, राइट दैट स्टेटमेंट। The statement was, Italy won in war. Italy won in war, but lost in peace. लड़ाई तो हम जीत गए थे, पर शांति में तुमने हमें हरा दिया, हमारे हिस्सा ही नहीं मिला। Now this will create social unrest in history, right? Social unrest will be there in Italy. That see the Italian soldiers, they died during the war, we were like, we lost money and we were promised territories and nothing has been given to us. Now whosoever will be ruling in Italy, they will not be respected because they could not get the results during Paris Peace Conference, so people are disillusioned with them. At the same time, because the Italians participated in the war and their economy started going down, they ended up spending so much in the war that now their economy is in the distress, because of which there is a possibility that socialism can come to this country. Socialism can come. Where socialism will come? Where there is poverty, where the workers are being exploited. Because there is possibility of socialism, the capitalist class in Italy, they wanted that there must be a strong leadership, so they will start supporting that candidate who will appear to be a strong leader, and that strong leader was Mussolini of the fascist party. Now, capitalists support some party, that means that party is getting a lot of funds. With these funds, they can go for campaigns. With the campaigns, they can win the elections. Now, Mussolini will come to the forefront. He will be very popular leader in the eyes of the masses, and his speeches are saying that, see, we have been betrayed in the war, and we have to take revenge for it. Italy has to get its share, due share, and everything. Now people trust him. When people trust him, he said, let's go for a march on Rome. The king lives in Rome. Let's go on a march to Rome. All the people will come with me. We will arrange a very big procession. And while reaching the palace of the king, we'll show that you all have trust in me. And then we all will raise hand that you want the king to appoint me as your new prime minister. So people said, yes, let's go. So there was a huge procession. People went. This is called March on to Rome. Mussolini led the march. And outside the palace of the king, he said, look, this is your country. This is your democracy. All the people want me to be the prime minister. Now tell me, am I prime minister or not? So what king can do now? Right? So king said, yes, you are appointed the prime minister, Mr. Mussolini. Great. Now that he's appointed the prime minister, after some time, he said, I believe in democracy. Let's go for elections, because I want people to trust that they have elected me properly. Now that you are already a prime minister, what is the problem that there are elections and you cannot win it? So he win the election. Now he come to power. And once he come to power, he said, listen, gentlemen, I tell you something. This democracy is very bad thing. It cannot let a strong leader survive for long. And we need a strong leader now. So from today, there is no need of democracy. No other party is allowed. All opposition parties are banned. there is only one newspaper run by the fascist party, only one radio channel run by the fascist party. Only those lawyers and judges can now continue who believe in fascist ideology, others can resign. Judiciary bhi control kar gaya, press bhi control kar gaya, opposition parties ban kar gaya. He turned into a complete dictator. Now he can do anything and everything that he wants. Now let's talk about Germany. Germany participated in World War I. They were a very big power, but they have been defeated. They have been devastated. When they were defeated and devastated, Germany then, you know, went for Weimar Constitution. A new constitution was written. Weimar is a name of a city where the constitution was written. So it is called Weimar Constitution. Now, when this Weimar Constitution was written, they said there will be democracy in Germany and the president or whatsoever is the position, it will be elected, right? So that means a Weimar Republic was established. Republic is where head of the state is elected. Now, Weimar Constitution written, Weimar Republic created. But there is a problem. The problem is Weimar Constitution created two things. One, proportional representation of electoral system. As we choose our president, nobody will ask me what is proportional representation here, because that will be explained in polity classes. Here you have to just remember the word proportional representation. And it also allowed multi-party system. Now, when we have a multi-party system, proportional representation will fail, because there will be never stability of the government. You elect some party, very soon it will collapse and new party will come. This Weimar Constitution and its proportional representation along with multi-party system created political instability in Germany. When it is political instability in Germany, now Germany, on the other hand, has been very badly humiliated in the Paris Peace Conference when they were made to sign that Treaty of Versailles. They were asked to give their territories. Country was divided on the 50th anniversary of unification. Then they were asked to leave their people in different parts. Then they were asked to reduce their army, navy, air force. What not is done to Germany, right? So there is feeling of revenge among the Germans. They want to take revenge. Now there is a person by the name of Hitler. He was a soldier, right? He was a soldier and then he was arrested. While being in jail, he wrote his biography, autobiography, Mein Kampf. Right? In this book, he started writing something very absurd. Now listen to it, what he said. He said, if you believe me, then the pure race Aryans have three traits. The pure race Aryans have fair complexion, blue eyes, and blonde hair. Now that's the Germans. Fair complexion, blue eyes, blonde hair, they are Germans. And these Germans, the pure Aryans, were destined to rule the world. That is why we had Bismarck. That is why we have Frederick the Great. And you know what happened? Then the Jewish people came to Germany. When the Jewish people settled in Germany, it is like the lions and the dogs living together. And to the most unfortunate thing that could ever happen, the German lionesses, the women of German origin, they copulated with the Jewish dog. Like had sex with the dogs, and the present generation is not the cub but the pup. इसीलिए बच्चे कुत्ते जैसे पैदा हो गए हैं. The weak Germans, and that is why Germany is defeated. Now, if you want Germany to regain its pride, its position, its place, exterminate the Jews, kill them, and make sure that Germany is great again. People are very happy with this speech because they are foolish people. Next, now that Hitler is talking of all these things. Now, what happens next? He became very clever and he went for a beer bar pushe. Now, what is beer bar pushe? He made a new poster campaign. What is this poster like? There is a poster. In this poster, this is shown to be the French and the German border, right? On this side, the soldiers are standing, the French soldiers. This is scene of World War I, right? The French soldiers are standing. But these French soldiers, they are not holding the gun like this, as if they are very, very enthusiastic. They are shown like this, that they are tired, they are fatigued, and they have given up. While the German soldiers on this side, they are shown like this, ready to fight and die for their country, but sure of winning the war. right? So the emotions shown in the picture is French are tired, they are about to surrender, Germans are very strong. Behind these German soldiers, the people who wrote the Weimar Constitution, they are sitting, right? And when they are sitting here, they are stabbing in the back of the German soldiers. So the people of Germany, the leaders of Germany who believe in democracy are shown as the backstabbers, that they stabbed in the back of the German soldiers and the blood is flowing. And from the blood of the German soldiers, the one who wrote the constitution is like putting his pen. The blood is used as the ink and the Weimar Constitution has been written. So the idea of democracy in Germany is written by those who backstabbed the German soldiers who were about to win the war, and they used the blood as ink to write the constitution. Now you realize why Germany was defeated in World War I, according to Hitler. He said, our own people were traitors. Why they were traitors? Because they are not pure Germans. They are the mixed blood of Jewish race. So guys, get up. This is time to get back Germany, its rightful place. And here I am, your best friend Hitler. Tell me, do you trust me or not? And people said, yes, we do trust you. Now, when the people said, yes, we trust you, he contested election for the office of president, but he could not win the election. He could not win the election and Hindenburg became the president of Germany. But his party, the name of the party is Nazi Party. The party win the election in parliament. When he won the elections in parliament, he becomes the chancellor of Germany. The leader of the majority party becomes prime minister. He becomes chancellor. Now that he becomes chancellor, something amazing happened. Now listen to it very carefully. When he became chancellor, after a few days, there was an incident of firing in parliament. Parliament was set on fire. That parliament is set on fire. He said, I believe that these are the communists who set the parliament on fire. So I have to arrest all the communist leaders. All the communist leaders arrested. He said, I think all the opposition leaders are like this. All opposition leaders arrested, all opposition parties banned. Only one newspaper, Nazi newspaper. Only one radio channel, Nazi radio channel. Only Nazi lawyers and only Nazi judges can work. All local bodies, municipalities, all khatam, power centralized in Hitler. Hitler said, see, there is no parliament. Where can I have the sessions? How can I get the bills passed? So let's pass Enabling Act. The Enabling Act says Hitler can anytime pass any law without parliament session. He has given all the powers. Meanwhile, Hindenburg died. Hitler said, I don't understand why there are two offices. One of the president, other of the chancellor. There is unnecessary duplication of the work. Let me hold both the powers. And the office of Führer was created. Hail Führer. This is how Hitler became the dictator in Germany. Smart man. Theek hai? Now Hitler has come to power. And now listen to it. Why people are trusting Hitler like this? Before Hitler came to power, there was such a high rate of unemployment and so many problems in Germany that Germans never thought that we can bounce back and get something properly in our hands. Such a huge unemployment. When he came to power, you know, he said, I promise you one thing, that your best time is about to come now. Right? Because I'm here, your best time is about to come. Don't worry. See the magic I can do. The moment he's elected, he said, all the women working in the factories go back home. You can't work. Women are meant to work in the homes. All the women sent back. The Jewish people sent them to concentration camp. They are about to die now. So Jewish people lost their jobs. They were sent to the concentration camps. The gypsies, the people who keep migrating, he said, don't like them. The gypsies and the transgenders, kill them. Now, there are more jobs and less men. There are many jobs. People are like, he's a magician, yaar. He said he will create job and see, there are so many jobs. We all are getting jobs and still there is unemployment. There is vacancy. Oh God, he's God. Right? People started trusting him like this. And whatever he said, everybody just kept a blind eye and said, yes, yes, yes. And he has a propaganda minister like Goebbels. The way he created the propaganda, that this is the only way Germany can rise. There is no other way. People started trusting it. Now to keep everyone glued to him, he started Young Hitler Society. In all the schools, when students will go to school in the morning in the assembly, there will be a portrait or a statue or a picture of Hitler. And they all will say, Hail Führer, we live and die for you. and he will talk to children through radio. Now we have to understand that policy of appeasement. Very simple. Britain says, if Germany remains weak, then Russia can take over German territories and there will be spread of communism. So we have to keep Germany strong. What is the basic meaning of appeasement? When you agree to somebody's wrong demands, that is called appeasement. When you agree to somebody's right demand, it is not appeasement, it is justified. But when you when the students come and say, sir, test mat lo, and I say, okay, that is appeasement. And when I say student test do, and student give the test, that justified way of teaching, right? So when I use the word appeasement, it means Britain is agreeing to the wrong demands of Hitler, right? Now, what happened? The British Prime Minister is Neville Chamberlain. And he said, see, World War I happened. And unfortunately, even if we won the war, we became very weak. America has become new power. Secondly, we were yet to come out of the scars of the war when the Great Economic Depression came. We are economically so weak now. At this point of time, can we afford a new war? No. So how can we tell Hitler he's mad? If we tell him don't do this, he may declare war. So let's buy some time. Let's keep Hitler happy for a while. Let's rebuild our capabilities. And then we can think of a fight against Hitler. But make sure that Germany is strong enough under a strong leader that Soviet communism is not entering into Central Europe, right? So let's be friends with Hitler. Even if he asks for some insane kind of thing, let's agree to it. Now, Hitler is given an impression as if we are happy whatever you are doing. Hitler said, in that case, Mr. Chamberlain, can you allow Germany to rebuild its navy? Chamberlain said, on one small condition, please don't make bigger than Britain. And I don't mind then. He said, thank you. Then he said, Mr. Chamberlain, is it possible that I can send my army into Rhineland because it makes me feel vulnerable? He said, okay, go ahead. France was crying that day. No, 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 Britain, please don't allow Hitler to send his army into Rhineland. It may create problem in near future. He said, don't worry, yaar. Haven't you heard what he's saying? He's talking about the term Lebensraum. Now, what is Lebensraum? Lebensraum is German policy of living space. Hitler said, I want to expand German territory up to Ural Mountains. That means I will take over entire Russia. Living space in the east. I will take over entire Russia. I will run over Russia and there will be no Russia. It will be all Germany. Britain said, wow, that's what we want. So let Hitler do this. Let us make him more strong now. He will fight against Germany, Russia. And that is what we want. See, what will happen? The communist Russia and the fascist Germany, they will collide. One will be defeated. The other will be very weak. We will defeat him. So let them fight first. So France said, are you sure? Britain said, yes. America was silent. So Britain said, go ahead. Hitler, tell me what you want. He said, I want my Czechoslovakian territory of Sudetenland back, in which there are 3 million Germans. Britain said, go ahead, take it back. Now Britain, that has created the system in Paris Peace Conference that Sudetenland with 3 million Germans will go to Czechoslovakia. He himself said him, go ahead and take it over. Hitler went, attacked and took the territory of Sudetenland. Britain said, great. Now Hitler said, I want entire Czechoslovakia, sir. He said, okay, I'm turning and blind. I go ahead and do it. Fatafat se kar le, kisi ko batayo mat. Hitler took over Czechoslovakia. Hitler said, I want Austria too. Britain said, thoda zyada hai. He said, but this is last. Please allow me. He said, okay, go ahead. He attacked Austria and Anschluss was carried out. Hitler brought Austria within Germany, what Bismarck could not do. Right? Now this is complete German unification. And at the helm of the affair is a Prussian, right? Though he's not a Prussian, he's a Bavarian. Now that he has brought Austria into his control, he said, how about Poland? Even that is part of it. And only then Danzigport can be connected. And that division of Germany into two parts will be over. Britain said, this is now getting over, yaar. This is too much. Even France is not very happy. In the back of his mind, Hitler thought, yaar, when I attacked Sudetenland, nobody said. When I attacked Czechoslovakia, nobody came. When I attacked Austria, nobody came. Now, if I attack even Poland, who will come? He attacked Poland and Britain declared war. World War II started. Now, shall we blame entirely Hitler for all this? Isn't it the policy of appeasement of Britain, which is equally responsible? If they would have checked Hitler at the start, he would have never been so strong. They intentionally let Hitler grow into a monster so that Hitler can be used in future against Russia. So the last thing here, very important last thing. When Hitler became very powerful in the end, before he has to attack Poland, he threw the biggest bouncer at Britain and everyone. Before attacking Poland, Hitler signed no war pact with Russia. I will not fight with Russia. And the British Prime Minister was like, I was helping you become strong so that you will defeat Russia, and you are becoming friends with Russia. Dare you attack Poland now? I will not leave you. And why he did so? You know why he did so? He said, first, I will make Russia my friend. When Russia will be my friend, I will attack France. I will take revenge for Versailles. After defeating France, I will attack Russia. He planned it again the same way. But he could not manage the things again. And America again came back. Again, the same fate. Germany was defeated. Now, what is totalitarian state? Totalitarian. Total control over the life of men. What will you eat? What will you wear? Who will you marry? How many children you will have? What will be your mode of entertainment? Everything will be decided by state. That is called totalitarianism.